Luke chapter 14. And when you have it, say, I got it. I believe that God, throughout this next few weeks, I believe that God wants to minister to all of us in this particular area of what a blessed life really is. In Luke 14, in verse 28, 29, and 30, the Bible says, it says, for which one of you, when he wants to build a tower or a building, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, this man started to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, will not first sit down and consider whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one coming against him with 20,000. Father, in the name of Jesus, one more time, minister to every one of us, God. I pray that you would use your word this morning, the scriptures that we will be reading, Lord, to be able to minister at whatever level that we find ourselves here today individually. Father, we love you. Thank you. Have your way, Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody says amen. Amen. You may be seated here this morning. The reason why, I could have opened this particular message with many different scriptures, but this one I believe is important because one of the things that we're going to be talking about this morning is found in this portion of scripture, and that is a strategy. There's a strategy to what the Bible is talking about here in Luke 14. He says that who in the right mind will begin to build a building and not having sat down and counting the cost. In other words, not having a strategy or making sure that he has or they have what it takes to be able to not only start to build it, but to finish it. How many know that we want to go ahead not only to be good starters, but we want to also finish well? And this is what Jesus is talking about, trying to bring in a message, a powerful message to the listeners and say, look, if you're going to follow me, that's what he's talking about. Anyone who's going to follow me, anyone that is going to be coming after me and trying to find out the blessed life that I give, then it's a person that first has to sit down and count the cost. You can't just start following me and then give up 2-3 weeks or 6 months into following me because you didn't count the cost. Jesus wants us as followers of his not only to begin to follow him and devote our lives to him, but that we will do it all the way to the very end of our lives. This is not something that we do just because we are in the home for 9 months or 12 months. This is not something that we do just because we are going through difficult times in our relationships and we're looking for answers and help me, Jesus, just until things get better and then thank you very much, goodbye. Jesus is saying, look, somebody that is going to be my disciple and somebody that wants to follow me has to first sit down, count the cost, and jump in. And when you jump in, you have already made a decision in your heart that don't matter what, I'm going to follow you for the rest of my life. I will finish. And he compares that to somebody beginning to build a building and not having sat down prior to that and counting the cost. He says people are going to ridicule that person that starts to build, but yet maybe he lays a foundation and starts building one wall, and then he has to leave it there because he didn't have enough money to be able to finish. Everyone that goes by and sees that building halfway up, hello, are going to say, wow, how dumb that guy was. Look at him. What, that's no good. He put all of his money into that, and he could only build one wall and the foundation. And it's raining now, and the whole thing is going down again, and he's going to, because he did not have a plan, a strategy to be able to get it done. And so Jesus is talking about like that, and then he goes into, or what king, he says, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, they're about to fight, what king will not first sit down and consider whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one coming against him that has 20,000? If you know that you're going to lose for sure, he says, maybe you can work out a deal. Hello, a treaty. Before that, no, we're not going to make it. Okay, we give you this part of the land. Just take it. Don't kill anybody. Hello, somebody. He said, you got to have a strategy on how you are going to overcome. A strategy, he says, to finish what we start, and a strategy to win the battle. God wants to raise up victorious followers. God wants to raise up victorious champions. That's what he's into. He doesn't want you to lose your fight in life. Hello, somebody. God wants you to have the type of life that he intended for you. And anything apart from that, you are losing because you're missing the mark. And God says, I want you where I want you, where I want to bless you, where I want you to experience the blessed life, but you must align yourself with my plan for your life. You must align yourself with my plan for your life. And so a lot of times we think that, you know, by the world standards, that having a lot of money or having it together in that area, that is considered the blessed life. We're going to talk a little bit about this area today because there are two major habits that can help us to defeat the sin and the destructive use of finances, of money in our lives. Because a lot of times we think that having more is having a blessed life. But we're going to be studying today that that's not so. That's not so. See, these two major habits that can help us to defeat the sin and destructive use of money are budgeting and giving. Two different habits that we must develop in our lives if we are going to have a healthy financial strategy. Now listen to this, okay? Budgeting or a budget controls money's power. I want you to know that. Budget or budgeting controls money's power, or better yet, when you budget, you're telling your money where to go. When you budget, you tell your money where to go. Giving is the second way. And giving simply disarms money's power. See, we can use money to do good, or we can use money to do bad. And there's a lot of people out there that are using the money to do terrible things. They are wealthy, but they're not blessed. And so today, we're going to begin there. So, because I know that there's a misconception about this word, bless, and connecting it with money. See, recent statistics show that on an average, in our nation, here in the United States, every single person spends 24% more than what they make. Now, just think about that. In other words, we, as people here in America, we spend $1.24 for every dollar that we earn working. We spend more than what we make. How do we spend more than what we make? We either beg, we steal, or we borrow. Begging only works for a little while. Please give me something. Please, please, please. Until there's too many times and I ain't giving you nothing no more. I don't care how much you beg. So begging has limitations or limits. It's not going to work anymore. Stealing, robbing, hello, has consequences. Hallelujah. So we better don't try to steal no more because, you know, last time I did 6 months in county jail. Hello, somebody. Stop stealing. So the one that we go to all the time is borrowing. Hello, somebody. So we're borrowers. We become very good at it. I'm going to be talking to you here this morning to let you know what the blessed life is all about. How many want to know what the blessed life is all about? Come on, how many want to know what the blessed life is all about? So, we borrow to buy a house. Come on now. Mortgage. We borrow to buy a car. We borrow for education, college. Come on now. We borrow to buy a TV. Hello. This was the first time in my whole life. Just about, I don't know, maybe 6 months ago, our TV went out. And I didn't have the money. But I have a credit, real good credit. And they had 18 months, no interest at all. And I said, you know, it's a good thing. In 18 months, we paid off. We never, you know, got a good deal. So went, got me a nice TV, man. First time ever that I got anything on credit like that besides a house or a car. That's pretty good, ain't it? I thought it was pretty good, but now you're looking at me like, man, you're a sinner. Look at me like that. I really don't. I never had a credit card for the same reason. I don't want to get in debt. I protect myself and protect my wife. You know what I'm saying? I don't believe in credit cards. I'm sorry, I'm an old-fashioned kind of young guy. But many people like to borrow and like to get things on a card. Just use the plastic. Use the plastic. Use the plastic. And you know what happens? What happens that many times you get high interest on what you get, on what you borrow. And you make the problem of not having enough even bigger than how it was before. Especially if you're married. Hello, somebody. Especially if you have children. And so you begin to get behind. You begin to dig a hole that you're going to have problems getting out of it. And so a lot of people deal with this area of being stressed out simply because they have made some mistakes or they borrowed too much or high interest rate. And all of a sudden you find that your life is going crazy and it's simply because you're not making enough money to be able to pay for all the debt that you got yourself into. Come on, somebody need to give him praise because you know I'm speaking the truth. I'm not just speaking to you, I'm speaking to all of us, but this is the situation, the condition of America today. There's other countries that they spend, you know, 90% of what they make and they're saved 10%. Not America. America spends almost 25 cents out of every dollar more than what we make. You're getting into a deeper and deeper and deeper hole like that. Someone said this. He says, if your output exceeds your income, then your upkeep will be your downfall. I thought that was good. He says, if your output, if your expenses exceed your income, what you make, then your upkeep will be your downfall. You're trying to keep on moving. You try to keep up with the bills. You try to keep up with everything that's coming your way. But you're stressed out because you don't have enough. And believe me, I've been there time and time again. And that's the reason why we need to have a strategy in every area of our lives. God gives us a strategy in every area of our lives. Every one of us, even including in this area, so that money or the need of money and all of that stuff is not going to be something that's going to kill our joy and our happiness. This is not going to be something that is going to have us, you know, stay up all night worried and anxieties and depression because we don't have enough money to take care of those things. God has a plan for your life and my life to be set free from the bondage of owing and bondage of always being worried about, are we going to have enough or not? Come on, somebody need to give him praise because God cares enough for you, God cares enough for me that he gives us a strategy on how to deal with these areas of our lives. Because God is in every area of our lives. So I'm going to give you a couple of things that will give us a healthy financial strategy and finding a blessed financial life. Because I believe that God wants that for each and every one of us. First of all, number one, I'm giving you biblical principles for a healthy financial strategy. Number one, your resources, your finances, my finances must be guided by God. They must be guided by God. If you want to find a freedom in this area, your finances must be guided by God. By that, this is what I mean by that, is that God's wisdom has to be in how you deal with your finances. God's wisdom, the wisdom of God, has to be in that area of your finances. You see, we're the kind of people that like to compartmentalize our lives. We create a certain compartment here, and this is the compartment of our relationships. Everything that has to do with my relationships, there's a compartment. And then there's another compartment of job and career. Either where I work or I'm studying and I'm trying to develop a career. And so that's another compartment. And then ministry is separate. So we have another compartment just for ministry. Going to church and doing certain things, maybe praying, maybe doing that. So that's another compartment. And then we have another compartment that has to do with our resources, finances, money. And many times we like to compartmentalize our lives. And when it comes to, you know, the relationships, we pray, we surrender to God. We say, Lord, you know, help me in this area. I'm struggling in this area of my relationship with this person or my children or whatever. And you pray on that and you give it to the Lord. Your job and career, you can do the same. Ministry, you're always praying, God, help me to be more effective in ministry, reaching people, whatever it may be. But many times when it comes to the compartment of finances, that specific area of finances, we can begin to tell God, God, I'm going to go ahead and close the door in this area because I can handle this one all by myself. And you begin to just keep God out of this particular compartment in your life that has to do with resources, finances, income, and paying your bills and doing all this area in your life, your credit cards and all that stuff, and God is not included in that area. So any area that God is not included in is going to be a mess. Sooner or later, it will be a mess because God is a God of order. We are the kind of people that we don't have it together. We're the kind of people that are going to lean on one side or the other. We don't know how to balance it out. We don't know how to do this thing. Sometimes, you know, we spend money where we shouldn't spend money. We cannot hold it because that thing, we like that thing a whole lot. I really like that TV, man. I cannot go without the TV. Come on now. And we begin to spend money sometimes like that. And God says, you know, the only one way that you are going to have success in this area of your life, number one, a building block that you have to establish in your life is that your resources, that area of your life, must be guided by God. Gotta let him in. If you don't let God in, how can he help you and give you wisdom and give you enough and create, you know, a little bit more finances or a margin in your life? How can he do that if you don't allow him to put his hands in that area of your life? It only makes sense. You're in a relationship, you don't let God come in, you're going to have problems until God comes in. And when God comes in, it means, God, I'm ready to follow your wisdom. I'm ready to follow what you know is best for this area of my life. And when you begin to follow what God is saying, things begin to work out. I said, things begin to work out when you allow God to speak into your life and you obey what he says because he knows more than you. God knows more than me. So when we allow God to speak into our lives and we follow it, not just speak to me, but no, I don't think so. And you do your own thing, it's not going to work. But when you actually say, God, how do I deal with this area of my life that I'm having problems and I know that I haven't given you this area of my life, but I need you to come into this area of my life because I want to have the victory there. When you allow him to come in, he will begin to bring order into that area of your life. You know that anxieties and depression, do you know where that comes from? It comes from having no control over certain areas of your life. When you know that you need to do something or the way that it needs to be, but you have no control about putting it where it needs to be, then anxieties and depression begins to come upon your life. That's why God needs to come in. Because when God comes in, he kicks anxiety, depression, and all this disorder out of your life. He begins to place things in order. And you know what happens when things begin to be in order in your life? Peace begins to come into your mind, to your spirit. You're walking under the Spirit of God, and there's peace in your life. Why? Because you know you are walking on solid ground. You don't have loose ends here and loose ends there. You don't have area that say, I don't know what's going to happen here because everything is upside down and messed up. You don't have to go there. Why? Because you know that the God that saved you is in control of that area of your life. How? Because I surrender this area to my God. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. We want to raise a people that walk in victory in every area of your life so that you can be blessed. Blessed by having peace. Blessed by having joy. Blessed by having purpose in life. Because when there's disorder in our lives, we have no purpose. It's like, what for? But when there's purpose, when there's order in our lives, we're excited. We get up ready. Oh, hallelujah. Why are you so excited? Oh, I got things going on in my life. We got stuff going on, man. Our marriage is getting better. We're planning a little getaway. Oh, my goodness. Good things are happening. Why is that happening? Things are in order. And we like it like that because we feel excited about it. We have life. But if things are upside down, if there's a lot of loose ends, if you don't know what's going to happen because, mistakes or decisions that you have made that came back and now they're biting your heart, hello, somebody, then there's a problem. See, a pastor said it this way. Pastor said it this way. He says, a blessed man may or may not be wealthy by the world's standards, but he enjoys a quality of life that most millionaires would envy. Oh, I got to read it for some of you. You need to wake up this morning. A blessed man may or may not be wealthy by the world's standards, but he enjoys a quality of life that most millionaires would envy. Why? Because there is joy, there is peace, there is contentment. When God is in it, you become a blessed person. There's peace in your life. Oh, somebody says, with $2 in my pocket, I'm good. Oh, yes, when you are right in the center of God's will in every area of our life, including the area of finances, you may not have a whole lot, but you have joy. You have happiness. You got purpose. Why? Because I know that my God is in full control of my life. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. You don't need a whole lot of money to be blessed. You just need to be right with God. You need to have a connection with God. That connection develops an attitude of gratitude, thankfulness, peace, joy, order in your life, in your mind, in your heart. There's order. Why? I'm blessed. I'm connected to the source of life. When you're disconnected to the source of life, there's chaos in your life. There's disorder in your life. You're trying to make it work, and you're trying to do this, you're trying to do that, and for whatever reason, it's not working out. It's not working out. You see, so when we give, sometimes when we give, we try to give to get back. Hello. But God teaches us that we give to give. We don't give to get, we give to give. I hope somebody gonna get it here this morning, gonna catch it. We don't give to get. In other words, we are simply generous people in obedience to Christ and we understand that God is in full control over our lives. See, many people give their tithes or finances as if God owes them something. I'm giving 10%. But I know he's going to give me a brand new car. I'll give 10%. I know he's going to give me a brand new, nice, big old house by the lake. Come on, he only does that for pastors. No, I'm just kidding.
What lake?
But a lot of times we're giving because I know God's going to give me. I don't give. And God promises to take care of us, but sometimes he takes care of us. He will bless us in a whole different way than what we were expecting. I know that if you do this, I know that you love me. Maybe God would never do that, or it'd take a long time to do that, but maybe he takes care of you in a lot of the areas that you're not even looking at. We expect them to do these certain things, and we give like, okay, where's my brand new car? It's not happening. And we begin to get like, oh, God doesn't work. No, it's just the motives, the heart, the reason why we give are wrong. Got to get right. The heart got to get right. See, many times God's blessings come in different ways than what we expect. Another pastor said this. He says, don't worry on how God will bless you, your tithes and your offerings. He might increase your income or lower your expenses. He might sustain your house appliances, or he might protect your health, or he just may very well keep your car out of the shop. One thing is for sure. When God is in control, he'll take care of you. He will take care of you. God is not a man that he shall lie. What he said, he will do. He will do. And when the Bible says that God will take care of your life, he will take care of your life. Sometimes he will just bring friends that can help you in the time of need. Somebody that will pray for you. You may be asking for something material, but God may bless you with good friends that will go in your life and help you. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. God is a good God. He would always come through for you. We can't keep chasing after, if I have this, if I have that. How about if I have a right relationship with God? And let him handle everything else, because he's got a better plan than I could ever make up or build up on my own. So if I surrender to his plan for my life, he's going to give me the best plan he's got for me. My thing is, I just got to get right with God and stay right with God. And whatever he wants to do, he wants to give me a lot of money, praise the Lord. If he doesn't want to give me a whole lot of money, he wants to give me a lot of friends, and a lot of good, praise the Lord. Maybe God knew that I can't handle a whole lot of money. Oh, Jesus. I'm starting to preach right now. Why don't you give me this, God? And God says, I know the end from the beginning. If I open this door, man, it's going to choke you later. I can't open the door for you. If I open the door, I'm giving you a ticket to go back to the world and perhaps end up in drugs and perhaps do this stuff. Perhaps if you chase after money and all the things and I gave it to you, maybe you go and you're going to hang yourself. Oh, yes, spiritually speaking, maybe you walk away from me. Maybe you don't come to church no more because of that. I can't give you those things. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. Being right with God means, oh, I'm blessed, I'm connected to God, I'm in obedience to the Lord, and he has taught me to love him and to be okay even with the little that he gives me. It's okay. I know, and I've talked to a lot of people who have lots of money, but they're not happy at all. So money is not the answer. Money is not being blessed. Obedience to the Lord. The peace of God in our lives. That we're walking every step in obedience to the Lord. That we're walking in the fear of God. That God knows that 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 he's Lord over our entire life, not just different compartments of our lives. You can go to this area, but not this area. There's a lot of dry bones in that area. There's skeletons in that compartment. Don't go in there. It stinks. Let him come in so he can clean it up. He can clean up all that stuff. He can clean it up and make it smell good. Hello. He can make that area of your life smell good, where you're able to just open it up and say, hey, I can be transparent about my relationships. I can be transparent about my finances. I can be transparent about my job and career. I can be transparent about my income tax. I can be transparent in every area. Why can you be transparent? Because I am walking in obedience to the Lord. I am blessed. I got nothing to be ashamed of. Come on. I don't have no guilt. I don't have to walk in guilt anymore. I don't know why, because I allow God to come in and put everything in order in my life, and I feel new. I'm new from the inside out. There is a new life because God is in control. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. God is a good God. Many times God's blessings come in different ways than what we expect. So first of all, our finances, our resources must be guided by God. Don't push him out anymore. Let him in. Let him in. He's not going to try to take your money. He's trying to bless your money. He's trying to bless your money. He's trying to bless you in those areas. Don't do things because I tell you to. Learn your Bible. Do things because God tells you to in the Word of God. But listen to him. Listen to him. I'm trying to preach what he says here, because some of us may not make time to read it or to study it. But in order for your life to be truly blessed, you have to walk in the standards of God. If you don't walk by the standards of God, I don't care. You can have the best plan in your life with your finances. But can I tell you something? If God is not in it, eventually you are building on a faulty foundation, and eventually it's going to collapse. Eventually, it will collapse. God says, let me in. Let me help you build. I'll build it on solid ground. I'll build it on a solid foundation. You will not go without. You will not go under. Your business is not going to go under. Come on now. You don't have to go bankrupt in this area. You don't have to worry about this. I will come through for you again and again and again and again. If you have experienced God coming through for you, I want you to just give him a big shout and begin to thank him. Come on now. I want you to begin to thank him. Come on, I want you to say, thank you, Jesus. Come on, I want you to say, thank you, Jesus. There's a lot of folks in this house that know that our God is good. There's a lot of folks in this place that know that our God is an awesome God. Come on, somebody need to give him praise. Hallelujah. Our God is an awesome God. Remain standing now. Must be guided by God. Let God in to your areas of your life. Even if you have compartments, can you open every door this morning? God wants to truly, truly render you blessed. Bless, bless, bless. I'm having a lot of problems in this area. Have you given it over to the Lord completely? Have you? Because see, if you turn it over to the Lord, even if the devil messes with you, Jesus is going to fight the devil for you and with you together. You have a partner with Jesus. You can overcome all those areas of your life that were bringing you down. Oh God, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you. Some of us need to create a budget, a strategy. God says, in order to finish what you started well, in order to win the battle, in order to really be successful and have victory in your life and be blessed, you must put a name to every dollar that you get. this so much money is going for my car insurance. This so much money is going for rent or for the mortgage. This so much money is going to here. Write it down. Write it down. Put it there. We're going to, all throughout this month, we are going to be praying that God is going to turn your financial situation around for His honor and glory. He wants to do that. I said, He wants to do that. He wants to bless you so that you have peace instead of being all worried about stuff. God wants to bring peace. And He wants to begin now. He wants to teach you how to be careful in this area of charging stuff and getting stuff on credit and financing and all that stuff. Sometimes the interest is killing you. It's bringing you down. And God has strategies on how to take care of all of that stuff. And He wants to see you blessed. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You. We thank You. We thank You. We bless Your name, God. I pray this morning, God, that every heart that is here is open to You. Every department and compartment in our lives is open to You. Is open to You. In the area of relationships, in the area of jobs, career, work, in the area, Lord God, of finances, in the area of ministry and spiritual life, all of it together form a life. Be Lord over our lives, God. Every area of our lives, I pray, in the name of Jesus. We're going to begin to sing this song, and I'm going to ask you from all over the place, all over the place. Come.